Good morning. Good morning. Greetings, people of the Presbyterian Church of Dover, members, friends, guests, those who are here in the sanctuary, those who are watching online. We are all glad. I'm glad all of you are part of this service. Just a couple of reminders that we want to continue to exercise social distancing and wearing our mask. We will not be singing. Which we haven't been doing. There will be no touching other than those that are related to you. We will be passing the peace, but it will be from your pew. You'll stand and you can look around. You can give a peace sign to folks, but we are not getting up and leaving the pew. We are adding some new elements to the service today. We'll do a responsive readings. We've included a confession of sin, an assurance of pardon. We have a prayer of illumination, and we have an affirmation of faith that will follow the sermon. After the service, our ushers will release you row by row to exit through the back of the sanctuary, where you're welcome to socialize outside. But we do ask that you still maintain social distancing and be careful. We want to keep everybody safe. I am encouraging folks to set up appointments with me. I'm wanting to get together and get to know folks. And the easiest way for me is if you say, I'd like to meet with you, and we arrange a time where we either do it here at the church, or I'm willing to go on the road some and either visit you at home or at some other place. Just let me know. I also want to encourage people to participate in the book study that we're doing with another one of our Presbyterian churches in our presbytery. The book is White Fragility, and we're doing it by Zoom on Wednesday evenings at 7 o'clock. We'll send out the Zoom invitation before Wednesday this week. Look at the calendar for the rest of the announcements. Notice that there are some groups that are starting to meet back here in the church. They will be wearing masks and exercising social distancing. And some of them are what we call hybrid meetings, where some are here in the building and others are participating by Zoom. We're still working out some of the kinks of that, but we'll get that figured out at some point. As I like to begin each worship service with this, whoever you are and wherever you are on your faith's journey, you are welcome here this morning, and we pray that the transforming love of Jesus might touch your life today. So I would invite you now to stand. We will pass the peace verbally within our pew or with signs, but stay there. Peace.
Trying to take off a mask and not throw your earrings across the room is always an experience. Good morning, members, friends, and visitors. We are glad you are here. Let us join in the call to worship. Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And blessed is the church that serves with the love of God to eradicate systemic poverty." Jesus says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And blessed is the church that trusts in the grace of God to build the congregational vitality." Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. And blessed is the church that seeks by the power of the Spirit to dismantle structural racism. Blessed are you, O holy triune God, and blessed is your holy realm forever." Let us pray. Holy God, by your word and spirit, come and transform your church to be a living sign of your love for the world. Where the poor are filled with good things, the dividing walls are broken down, and the dead are raised to new life through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
continue our worship, let us move into our communal prayer of confession. A voice is crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin. Merciful God, we confess that you have wandered from your way of truth and life. You call us to share all that we have and work together for the common good. But we hoard up treasures for ourselves and deny others their daily bread. You call us to set the captives free and seek justice for the oppressed. But we live in fear of our neighbors and hide ourselves from our own kin. You call us to walk in newness of life and to be witnesses to the resurrection. But we dwell in the valley of dry bones and keep silent about your saving love. Forgive us, God of grace. Set us free from sin, death, and fear, so that we may serve you with gladness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Hear now as we silently confess our sins. Amen. Hear the good news. In Christ Jesus, we are forgiven. So live into this good news. Please join me for the prayer of illumination. Speak to us, O God, with the voice of your Holy Spirit, that we may know the way of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from Matthew, chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a shout, "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all the bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you or for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." The word of the Lord.
Come.
Our second reading this morning is from Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability, and then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed me 2 talents, and see, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy servant. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, Master, I knew you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and I hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master replied, You wicked and lazy slave! You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and that I gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, you would have received what was my own with interest. So today, take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But for those who have nothing, even that will they be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be reaping and gnashing of teeth.
We've been reading through Matthew 25, the whole chapter, once I finish reading my part. And I'll talk about that as we go along. But we conclude the chapter 25 with verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, You that are accursed, depart from me into eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me, naked, and you did not give me clothing, and sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. then they will also answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Shortly after I arrived here, early in the spring, our session voted to become a Matthew 25 church. This is an initiative that's been started by our denomination that takes Matthew 25 and asks us to live it out, focusing on three things. One or more things. One is to the revitalizing of the church. Two is the eradicating of systemic poverty. And three is the dismantling of structural racism. Now, our presbytery has joined to be a Matthew 25 presbytery. We're one of eight churches within our presbytery that has joined to be Matthew 25. Over the next few weeks, I want to do a sermon series on being a Matthew 25 church. And today, I will focus on the chapter itself, the three parables that we've heard, and how they relate to being a Matthew 25 church. Then next week, I'm going to take stories from the Old Testament and show how they can be interconnected to deal with the three focuses that Matthew 25 wants to emphasize. And we'll talk about that. And then I want to take each of one of those focuses and spend a week individually talking about each one and see where this takes us. But I have to admit, when I heard about this Matthew 25 initiative, my thought was it was primarily and only dealing with this last parable, the one that I read about the sheep and the goats. But as I've looked at the other two parables, I can see a connection with them on our being a Matthew 25 church. So we're going to look at the three parables and see how they relate to being a Matthew 25 church. The first one is the parable of the bridesmaids. And you need to know a little bit of a context of how weddings worked back in that day. Weddings were times of great celebration. And often the whole town participated. And you might recall Jesus' first miracle was turning water into wine, and that was part of a wedding celebration. But because the wine was running out, this was going to be a social embarrassment for the bride and the groom. But here's kind of what would go on in one of these weddings. The groom and the groom's party would leave the groom's house, and they would walk to the bride's house. And they might not go the most direct way. They probably stopped and picked up people along the way and took their sweet time. And then when they got there to the bride, the whole party would go back to the groom's house. And for sure, they're going all the back streets and everything so that everybody can join into the celebration. And then when they get there, they party for several days, even up to a week, I understand. Well, in this particular parable, the groom was delayed, and the 10 bridesmaids, 5 of them came prepared and 5 of them did not come prepared. They had enough oil to last the delay. Those that were wise and those that were not wise, they were running out and they needed to go get more, and therefore they missed the whole thing. Now, this parable is an allegory, which means each part of it has meaning. The wedding is the coming of the kingdom of heaven. The groom is Jesus. We are the bridesmaids. Now, the tricky part of this parable is, what is the oil? What is that thing that we possess, those of us who are wise, that we cannot share with the unwise. And I would suggest to you that the oil is our commitment to Christ. It is our growing and maturing as disciples of Jesus. It is our faith, but and we talk about giving our faith away, but that part of our faith, that commitment we have and all that, that's not something that we can share with others. That's something we own for ourselves. And this faith that we have allows us to make it through the delays. It allows us to make it through the good times and the difficult times. The good and the bad, and we're ready for it, whatever comes. And I think this is kind of what Jesus is getting at here. And as a Matthew 25 church, we count the cost. What does it mean to be a Matthew 25 church? And how do we live this out? And what commitments do we need to make so we can stay diligent? So we don't want to lose heart. We don't want to give up once we've started. We want to live it out to the end. So that's the first parable. The second parable is the parable of the talents. And this is a parable we often use during stewardship time, of telling people they need to give of their time, their talents, and their treasure. And we think of talents being our gifts and the natural abilities and such. But in this parable, talents is a sum of money. It's a large sum of money. It's like 15 years of wages for the common worker. So the person that received 5 talents, he received 75 years of wages for the common common worker. Even the one that just received 1 got 15 years worth. It's a significant sum of money. And we want to look at this parable a little bit, and I want to help keep us understanding who we're talking about. I'm going to give us names to the three people involved. Not anything smart or original or anything. We're going to name them 5, 2, and 1. Well, 5 and 2, they took their talents and they doubled them. Now, I have to imagine that when they went out and doubled their talents, they had to take some risk. You don't just double your money easily. It involves taking some risk. Otherwise, everybody would have done it. So they took some risk and they were able to double what they had been given, what they'd been entrusted with. Now, one... He didn't do that. He was scared of possibly losing it. He was not willing to take any risk, so he took and he buried it. Something that was common in that day. You would bury your treasure so it might not get lost or stolen. And when it comes time for the rewards, the 5 and 2, they come in and say, Here, I've doubled what you gave me. And the master responds, "You good and trustworthy slaves, you've done great. Enter into my kingdom. Enter into the joy of my kingdom." And then comes the one. And one starts off with, "I know that you are a harsh man." Where is he getting that from? We aren't given any indication that the master was a harsh master. He wasn't that way with 5 and 2. But that's how one perceived him. And because one perceived him as being harsh, he did not want to risk losing what had been given to him, so he'd taken and buried it. And the master became quite upset. You know, I'm sure one didn't expect to get this big old attaboy. You did great, come on in. But neither did he expect to be cast out into the darkness. And I think the lesson for us in this is that we have to recognize the talents that God has given us, the resources that God has given us, and then be willing to take risk with those things. Don't just sit on them, but use them for the purposes of God. And so what are some of these resources we have? We begin with the people. We are a diverse, talented people with a lot to offer. And then our building and our location. We are right here in downtown Dover, the capital of the state. And we, I believe, have a responsibility to talk truth to power. We have to be that truth that speaks out, even when those in power don't want to hear it. And then second, we have Wesley College right over here next to us. A new generation coming up. And we have an opportunity to have an influence in their lives. What an opportunity to help prepare them for life that is ahead of them. And then to our rear, we have a good number of people that live in poverty. And the Bible speaks over and over of God being on the side of the poor. And we have the opportunity to join in on that. And this kind of brings us to that third parable, the sheep and the goats. And I have to tell you that this is a parable that can be quite troubling. Because if I were to say everybody who considers themselves a sheep, using the definition that Jesus uses, that can go over onto this side, and those of you that are goats who didn't do what Jesus said, go over to this side. Now, as I look at my life as a whole, I think I have to go with the goats. There are times that I've done these things that Jesus said, but I think maybe overall it's been more on the goat's side. And I don't know about you. Maybe you'd be with me on the goat's side. I like to think there'd be some on the sheep side. I like what Anne Lamott says. She's a Presbyterian author. And she says, who was it who said that to get into heaven, you needed a letter of recommendation from the poor? What a buzzkill. If you're around me enough, you hear enough of my sermons, you know that I preach grace, God's grace. That there is nothing we can do to either earn or deserve God's grace or God's love. It is a gift that has been given to us from God through Christ. And you look at this parable and you say, well, where's the grace in this? This sounds like works. And I would agree, except for one thing. There's this crazy little twist in this parable. And that twist is that neither the sheep nor the goats realized that they were caring for Jesus. When did we see you poor or naked or hungry or sick or in prison or a stranger? When did we see you that way? Well, whenever you did it for one of the least of these, you have done it for Jesus. What I think is going on here is that when we give ourselves to Christ, when we give our hearts to Christ, Jesus begins to work and to shape and to mold us into that image of Christ. And when he does that, we start to respond the way Christ would have us respond. So in other words, the sheep were doing this instinctively because of their love of Christ. And the goats were instinctively not doing these things. So that in reality, when we are followers of Christ, this desire to care for the poor and the sick, the needy, the naked, the prisoners, the strangers, it becomes part of our DNA to work and help and be with them. And so let me wrap this up. Being a Matthew 25 church means that we are wise like those five bridesmaids who had prepared for the delay. We allow our faith to lead and to guide us as we wait for the coming of Christ. And we count the cost, and we're diligent in the work that we're doing. We're like the talents. We're like five and two in that we take risk. We don't sit back with the status quo, but we say we're going to move forward, we're going to take risk, and we're going to see what comes of it. You know, the parable didn't talk about anyone losing the money that the master had given them, but I wonder about that sometimes. I think the master would even understand if someone lost it, if they had been taking risk and doing what was right. And I think it's that way in the church also. We can take risk, and sometimes they work and sometimes they fail, but we want to take what's been invested, what's been entrusted to us, and invest it. We want to establish relationships in our community, establish relationships with the powers over here, the young people over here, and the poor people behind us. We want to create these relationships that allow us to have an impact on their lives. And when we do these things, I think we become a vital, energetic, enthusiastic, healthy church doing what God has called us to do. So in the coming weeks, we're going to look more closely at this. And we're going to have opportunities at some point during all this to talk about these things, what it means to be a vital church, what it means to eradicate systemic poverty, what does it mean to dismantle structural racism. We want to be able to get people's feedback and dialogue about these things. What does it mean for us as this church in this place at this time? What does it mean to be a Matthew 25 church? I think it'll be a wild and exciting ride, and we'll see what God might do. I want us to join together now doing an affirmation of faith using excerpts from a brief statement of faith that's found in our Book of Confessions. And I would invite you to stand as we do this responsively. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. We trust in God, whom Jesus called Abba, Father. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. With believers in every time and place, you may be seated. We want to enter into the prayers of the people, and I've been having us do these breath prayers as we enter into this time, and I want to do that again today. As we inhale, we say, God is good. as we exhale, we say all the time. And if you're really good, you can switch that around. The second time you do it, you say, God is great all the time. All the time, God is great. I'm probably not coordinated enough to do that. I'll probably, in my breath, and we're doing this silently. I'll stick with God is good all the time. But let us take a few moments to prepare for entering, for preparing it or beginning our prayers of the people with our breath prayer. Our gracious and loving God, we ask that you lead and guide us as we seek to be a Matthew 25 church. May we count the cost and be willing to go the distance. May we be good stewards of all the resources that you have entrusted to us. And may we see you in the people that we encounter, especially the least of these in our society. As a result of this, may our church be revitalized, empowered to be your people in this place and at this time. Earlier this week, O God, we remembered 9/11 and the death and destruction that was wreaked upon our country. And we ask that you continue to be with those who grieve the loss of loved ones. We pray for those first responders who continue to suffer both with physical and mental health issues, and ask that you might bring healing to them. We ask that you might bring healing to our divided country at this time. We would ask that you be with those on our prayer list, and that you might hear and answer their prayers. Be with each and every one of us here today, that we might love you and love others as you've commanded us to do. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus and offer up the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.